Greetings and welcome. I'm stalling out here momentarily. As I originally looked up at the clock, I saw 11:11. Welcome. Thank you for stopping by here on TikTok Live at The Real Bloom From Within Love. I go by Bloomy. Original air date is Wednesday, May the, 24th, 2022. Otherwise, if you're logging on to the YouTube platform on any date, welcome. Anything y'all need to know about me should be listed in el description box. Now, the title I think I put in there, as you guys are clicking on, I think I put True Generosity. And then I put Narcs are children, true generosity, Narcs are children. And I will explain really what I mean by that. Okay. It was something that I've experienced just in general, not with any one person. It's something that I have been taking note of when dealing with these personality types or people that are really in that energy. Another thing I've understood here lately is that because the fear and ego based grid is simply based in narcissism, there are more narcissistic energies than we want to acknowledge. The thing is that not everybody is in a severity. Not everybody is in an extreme version of narcissism. Not everybody has gone to the left field, you know, where they're really just like sicko psycho. You know, because it's a spectrum. Okay. So, but this is something in my studies, in hermit modes, in my experience, as well as my own higher guidance team, has pointed out about a common thread. No matter where you go, no matter what the culture is, no matter what the ethnicity is, no matter what the socioeconomic background is, there are some commonalities in every last one of them, okay? And you'll see it. You will actually sense it, see it, and feel it. It's very simple, okay? So I want to talk about really quickly just true generosity. Because here's why, depending on the type of narcissism you are dealing with individuals, groups, or organizations, family members, lovers, whomever, depending on what type of narcissism they operate in, they may be what's called a generous narc. Okay. But so that is why I put true generosity. I put that true in front of it for a reason. As I was, you know, talking to someone the other day, and this is an individual that this person is well into their, I want to say they got to be in their maybe late 50s, maybe early 60s. Okay, so age, you know, doesn't exclude them. Quite frankly, the older, the worse it is, because that stuff has been sitting there for a longer period of time. That individual has been operating like that for a longer period of time. So I was talking to an individual that this person, okay, this person is a very generous person, okay? I've watched, okay, because something I do now that I used to didn't do before, I'm very observant. Well, I always was, but this time I'm doing it with specific intention. So I sit back and I'll watch. And so this individual, this particular male energy, that's, I want to say they gotta be 50s, 60s, gotta be. Okay. They're Caucasian background. They have, they are well off, well established. Okay. They have a lot of money. They are popular, they're known, and they are generous. Let me explain. I've watched this individual go out of their way to do all sorts of kind acts. Like they connect to, you know, church members, they connect to groups and organizations to do things for the homeless, to do things for those that are disadvantaged. You know, this particular gentleman, he has a truck. So I've watched him like just go all out, right? And just like generous, sacrificial. But I'm about to bring in how is the narcissism coming in? Because I feel like a lot of people, this is why so many are trapped or stuck in things and scratching their heads and not knowing what to think or feel, because essentially it's like, how is someone a narcissist if they are always going out their way to go give this to this person, or they're always, you know what I'm saying? How is that possible? And this is because people don't understand narcissism. They mix generosity or somebody doing acts of service necessarily with that of divinity, and it's just not true. Okay. So this particular gentleman that I'm talking about, this is where I started seeing the real get down. Well, if you start listening as they're talking to you, and as they're talking about, you know, the acts or, you know, whatever the situation is, you may catch and start to hear that there's an attachment. They have an attachment to what they're doing. Because this particular gentleman made a comment about someone else to me. Okay. They made a comment to me that, this is free. They made a comment to me that they were upset. Because, see, I have this knack. I do have a knack of getting people comfortable to talk to me. Okay. It's my natural energy. It's because my heart is pure and I try to stay neutral. So people have a tendency to feel safe. So I listened to him and he said he was upset with this one individual, this one lady that he had done a lot of help for. You know, it wasn't a family member of his or anything, no personal, you know, associations, just somebody, you know, that he had done a lot of, you know, acts of service, if you will, pro bono, voluntary work, because he wanted to. It was this single mom. She has, I think he mentioned something, she had three kids and, you know, yada, yada. And he said, I'm upset. I'm upset with her. And I said, why? And he said, because, you know, I did all of this and this and that for her. And I had invited her. See, he's a type of person. He's a religious narc. I invited her to come to church, to at least come to one service, and she never comes. And I just listened to him, and I let him talk. I didn't like get on his case or nothing. I just let him say it. And then he went on to talk about other things. And I was like, huh. So I was picking it up. And then I made a comment. But I made a comment in a very neutral way just to see what the response would be. And it only further proved my point. And I said, oh, okay. I said, I get it. I said, so you were asking her to come to church and, you know, she never came to your church after, because you said after everything that you did to assist her and her three children. And I said, well, and this is how I did it. I said, you know, I said, I have had to learn that if you're going to give anything of yourself, whether it is your time and your resources or whatever that is you feel guided to do to assist somebody, let it be out of the purity of your heart without an attachment. And if you can't do that, maybe you shouldn't do the act of service then. If you're not able to do it without attaching an expectation that, because that's a form of manipulation. If you're not able to do it out of the sheer divinity of you, because you have the resources to do so, or because you feel guided to be of a service to someone without needing to get something out of the deal. I said that, well, it's best if, you know, because we have a right. See, it's not about trying to force anybody. It's really about identifying it. If you can't do that, then maybe you need to tell yourself that perhaps you ought not do it, because, you know, people have a right to choose for themselves. If she don't want to come to your church, she has a right to do that. Okay. If your service to her was simply to hopefully try to recruit her, everybody's not looking to be recruited. Okay. And that is manipulation. What is the driving force behind you assisting this woman? What if she had her own church? What if that's just not her belief system and she has the right for that to not be her belief system? What if she had already gone to your church or another church and heard all what you're talking about? So there's an attachment. That's control. This is narcissism. Control. If I do all these acts, if I give, I expect you to turn over your rights as a human to decide for yourself what you want to do with your life. I expect to be able to intrude on your boundary because I helped you and your three children. That's narcissism. It's a violation to someone else's divine right to choose. If, you know, like I said, if he or anyone else didn't want to be helpful unless, okay, you come, then, okay, well, understand that some communicate that, and then chances are those people would turn it down. Okay, well, no, thank you. I know I've done it. I made it clear so that it was understood. Like, no, no, thank you. I'm good. I can offer you a thank you and maybe some snacks, and, you know, as I'm guided, you know, for your kindness, but I'm not selling my soul for you. I don't need that. I know who I am. If your assistance is contingent upon that, no, thank you. But that's the whole point, you see. That's appearance of service and generosity is an attempt to control, an attempt to recruit into fucking cultic energy. Everybody ain't looking to be a part of no group. Shit. Okay. And these are markers that would help some of you out there to start looking past this external generosity, this external acts of service. There's something attached to it. I have learned that when people have to attach, I let you do this, so no, no. Now, please hear me out in balance here. I'm not talking about business. I'm not talking about, you know, the operations of the flow of business where there's a collaboration. Okay. I'm not talking about that, where there's some type of an exchange, communication, collaboration, trying to, you know, come up with a win-win and some type of a partnership and, you know, acts of service or bartering or any type of exchange in that way. But that's still done with integrity. There's no sneaky energy to it. There's no under the cuff energy to it because the intention is not to be that. When people have to have that sneaky under the cuff energy, that's a lack of integrity. It's narcissism. It's an attempt to control and to get someone trapped in something. And then someone could come out, boom, with the sidewinder. Oh, now, because I have done this, I expect that you turn over your rights to me. No, thank you. I expect because I was kind to you and I allowed this, that you let me abuse you. No, thank you. Right? So being generous does not mean someone is divine. That's why I said true generosity. True generosity, it comes from the heart space without malevolent energy, without ill intent or manipulation tied to it. Meaning, I am in a position that I am able to so-and-so-and-so-and-so, do so-and-so-and-so-and-so. I feel drawn by my compassion to assist. I don't need them to sign their life over to me. I don't need them to sign their creativity over to me. I don't need them to become a part of my group. I don't need, because that's not my drive. My drive is my heart. And that individual has a right to their path. If I feel like I can't do that, then I need to not do it. I need to go on with my get down and need to be more honest with myself, because my giving ain't really what I'm calling it to be. My giving is some other shit. Trying to gain a voice or a space or an authority or some type of a control or influence in a sneaky way. This is how people get in. Oh, look how giving they are. You see how they sweeping the floor? You see how kind they are? They sweeping the floor. And oh, you see what they did? They bark, you know, them this and they bark them that. Oh, you see? And then, but then people still be sitting down scratching their head like, what the hell? What am I in? What the hell did I do to myself? Because there was an attachment to that kindness, that so-called generosity. They needed your soul. They needed your energy. They needed, you know what I'm saying? Whatever the fuck. Right? Now, the other side, I think I put on the title, I said, narcs are children. This is also something else I've been observing and studying. And again, like I mentioned, this gentleman is, like I said, he ain't a young man. Quite frankly, it's like the older they get, the worse they are. It's like anything else. The longer you've done something, the more ingrained it is. Okay. So it's like, wow. Now, as I listen to the same gentleman, it's the same gentleman. Okay. On the surface, I remember watching. I was like, oh, you know, just sitting back and watching and listening, you know, to other people and kind of watching the dialogue there. And just, I was like, well, you know, okay. But then as I started paying more attention, I'm like, listen, just listen to them. They need constant attention and validation. You'll see it in their conversation. You also see that they hide that they're fearful and actually fearful and angry. And they hide it, and it comes out in the strangest ways. And so since I've been paying attention, I'm like, this is what this is. Because when narcs are children, and what I mean by that is teenagers or young adults and children, the developmental capabilities, if you will, okay, emotionally, intellectually, mentally, I'm not talking about academia, because some of these people are brilliant. Okay, so I'm not talking about academia. I'm talking about, you know, intrapersonal skills, emotional intelligence, social, all these things. Okay. A child and teenagers, because of the stages and phases that they are in their physicality and their physical development, okay, and also depending on their environment and culture and what they've been structured into and conditioned into as well. But they don't have, they're very needy. They need constant validation, constant stroking. And so they're always, you know, doing things to get somebody to try to elicit a compliment or to get somebody to stroke something. It's constant. It's almost constant. Okay. And if you try to shift the conversation in a different way, or if you try to be more organic and have like just a natural flow, you'll notice it's almost like they get dead eyes. It's almost like they're totally disconnected. I swear, I have seen this. It's almost like they go offline or something because they're the self-absorption. Nothing really exists to them. If it's not about stroking something that they need stroking in that moment, it's hard for them to have a sincere, organic, and authentic balanced exchange and being fully present and exchanging with another human being without it being geared and fashioned towards them. I watched this with more than one person, but I watched this with this particular gentleman. I was like, oh, no, I found it fascinating, actually. I'm taking notes. I was like, huh. Then, you know, because like I said, I have a tendency, people get comfortable with me. So then he starts talking, people will do that with me. They will talk. Okay. So I'm getting his whole get down. Okay. He telling me his whole get down. About him and his wife, the story of him and his wife, and things of that nature. But what I started hearing out of it, I was like, oh, snaps. He's a little bit abusive too. But you wouldn't know it. This is that covert shit. The little funny comments, a lot of the jokes that narcissists make is truths about their secret dark side and not the good dark side, okay? The part of them that they're trying to convince themselves in the world doesn't exist. Where they're violating people's boundaries, they're, you know, some of them downright abusive, okay? Whether that's verbally, mentally, emotionally, physically, sexually, spiritually, energetically. Anytime you're in a bullying energy, that's abuse. I don't care how we fancy it up and doll it up. You can say Bible, church, Jesus, all whatever names you want to use according to your get down and background. But if you're in that kind of energy, it's abuse and it's narcissism. To try to dictate and control and constrain or punish or harm or anything of that nature, anything that is not bent towards how you feel it ought to be bent. Grown motherfuckers, human motherfuckers, humans, I'm saying, even not grown, humans. Not objects and puppets, but that's not the narcissistic brain wire. It's not as such. They act like they love, but they don't. They really don't. I'm just going to be real. The only way to true love energy is actually awakening, healing, and ascension. Otherwise, it's bullshit. It's surface. True love energy, divine source light energy, there are certain things that one just will not be able to do if one is truly there. They're teenagers. This is why they have hissy fits. Just start paying attention. This is why. Just start being observant for yourself. Don't say nothing. Just let the people, like I've been doing, just let them do their shit. Let them say shit and watch their ass. And listen close. Listen close. They lack boundaries. That's one of the markers of narcissism. Narcs, they have no regard for individuals' personal space and boundary. They just don't. They feel entitled in their disillusionment that they have created in the mind to intrude upon others. Oh, somebody says, I love you. I didn't even see that. Oh, whoever said that. See, I wasn't even looking at the screen, y'all, so I'm sorry. I'm not being rude to anybody. Most of the time, I just be saying, I be on one. I'm moving my hands. I'm doing shit. So I ain't even seeing the screen. Sorry. So it's not like that. I promise y'all it ain't like that. But because of culture, see, here's the thing now. This is why I'm saying it was just an enlightening experience for me. I'm finding it fascinating, but also I'm feeling a lot of empowerment with this because no matter what spectrum they're on, because not everybody is severe, again, okay? Not everybody is a American Psycho movie, right? I've met them motherfuckers too. I got something special for them. But I'm not talking about the ones that are on that side. Because them, I'm asking team to do something nice and special for them type. Okay? But the others are more, you know, they're just the mind of a child, a teenager. So they have hissy fits and shit. You can't, you know, they can't have adult mature, you know, life or connections. You know, everything is a Peter Pan syndrome. If it's not all about, you know, the fun, the party, the excitement, you know, the play side, it's almost like they really can't handle anything away from that. And this is where you'll see the hissy fits and the projection and the triangulation and the gaslighting, the scapegoating, the deflecting, the denying, the lying, because they don't want to face themselves. They can't. They're like children. So it's easier to live in the world of illusion they've created. No, it couldn't possibly be something wrong with me. Someone asserting themselves will take them off the rocker because they can't handle people asserting boundary. They take it as a personal offense because someone dared to have a boundary and say, excuse me, you know, you're invading either my personal space or I don't like being spoken to in that manner, or you know what I'm saying? They don't have any awareness. They take it all as an assault versus, oh, okay, you know, then I apologize. Maybe I wasn't paying attention. You know, an adult, healthier person attitude, even if, you know, they could have possibly intruded in some way, when someone brings it out in a respectful manner, that adult healthy mind and individual, you know what I'm saying, then go, oh, okay, hey, you know what? That is not really how I meant to be, or I wasn't fully aware that that's how I came off, or that's how I was speaking to you, or, you know, I wasn't even aware that I was crossing a personal boundary. You know, an adult person can handle it without getting defensive and needing to attack or needing to have a rebuttal. Narcissists do not listen for understanding. They only listen to try to figure out a way to win, to come up with a rebuttal, because they're not interested in true healthy connections. They're not interested in truly getting to win-win in a dynamic, or truly understanding or coming to a place of commonality and fairness for everyone. Not truly. They like to pretend this shit, but not truly. especially if you're getting in the way of they get down. And if they look at you like a threat, that's a whole nother conversation. Because if they see you as a threat, you have become the target of their fixation. You've become the target for them to destroy, whether they say it out loud or not. But this is why they then do what they do. Is that, see, this is the more cynical, the more American Psycho version. The ones that's leaning on that side, because they went to the crazy side, the extra. They're not just teenagers having hissy fits. They gone altogether. Because now they're in this energy of feeling like they have a right to destroy anyone, to kill or to destroy anyone they feel is more powerful than them, or they feel has more gifts than them, talents than them, beauty than them, opportunities than them, success than them. Isn't that sick? Isn't it? It is. It's sick. It's a sickness. They're gone. But you wouldn't know it. See, the reason why I'm saying all this is because we're expecting it to look a certain way, but it often looks like the gentleman that I'm telling y'all about, people that go all out of their way all day, every day to be super kind and generous to people. So this is how they get people in their narcissistic spell web. Because they put on that Stafford wife outfit or Stafford husband outfit to the public. Just like I talked about, you guys, that movie Run, that's on Hulu. Highly recommend you all watch that movie. It's called Run. It's the epitome of what I'm talking about. To the world and the public, that particular mother looks like a saint. But to that daughter that she was freaking sabotaging, she was the devil. Do you see where I'm going? When we stay stuck looking at people's external acts, we will get fucked up. In that movie, Run, she looks like a mother that had sacrificed everything for her special needs handicapped kid that she actually fucking, if you go watch the movie, I don't want to ruin the movie. Because the sad thing is that young woman really wasn't handicapped. She had been sabotaged into it by her mother. But the world wouldn't have known that. If somebody were to try to come say something about that lady, nobody wouldn't believe it. That nice lady, she always smiling and bringing muffins and cupcakes and macaroni and cheese and shit to motherfuckers. She always donating something. She always smiling and, oh, you know, she may be soft-spoken and she may, you know, all the little, the get down, the whole little persona. Oh, let me buy this for little John. She's always buying something and shit. Straight trying to kill her own motherfucker. Kill her own fucking daughter. Sabotaging her because she codependent and fucked up in the head and needy as fuck. But I'm here. Look at me take care of my daughter in a wheelchair. See how much I go to the pharmacy and how much I help her with. These are the worst kind I'm talking about right here. I cook, I make her meals and her medicine all her life, and you know, I the bitch was fucking poisoning her so that she would be paralyzed. Some sick shit. And it's real. People think this shit is just the movies. No, it's not. It's real. It's a mental ill motherfuckers gone to the way left that have managed to create an illusion and a profile and persona to the world. That they're these upstanding, godly citizens of society. People buy that shit. Until it's they ass to that shit. You know, it's coming now. It's going to turn into something else on their ass. Until they figure out every time they ate that cupcake, they didn't feel too good. Shit. They couldn't think straight. Why I can't think straight every time I go over that motherfucker house? Every time I have sex with that hoe, what the fuck? Yeah, figure the shit out. So, I'm sorry, it's funny to me. Because it's a lesson. To me, it's like it is a lesson, a call to learn how to think in depth and to learn how to wake up and to not be so stargazed at people's performance. Like, yeah, my father. Just like I said, this the gentleman I'm talking about. After he started sharing so much, I was like, oh. And you know what? Another thing I was able to pick up is I was listening to my body. I started like tapping in. I was like, see, empaths, now I'm starting to really understand the role of Hioka or empath. I see why this happens. I'm starting to notice when I'm around certain individuals, even still, even having gone from Sodom and Gomorrah, because I'm gauging energy. I've noticed that when I'm around, you know, certain people, it's like a blissful or like peace. And then I kind of know, I'll kind of sense something. I'm like, okay, they probably, you know, are a very loving person, or they have a healthy heart chakra or some shit like that. I'm listening to my body. I don't have to know them. I'll get around them. And I'm like, okay. Others, I'm starting to pick up. I'll be like, ooh, they got some, I don't know what the fuck. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, either they oppressed and they got some other shit, motherfucker. I don't say nothing because it's not for me to. It's not about that. But it's so that I can gauge, like, either they have some personal things going on in their life and they got a lot of heavy baggage and burden, but either way, still, I can sense some heavy density. This one over here, I can feel if it's something towards me, oh, I feel it. They don't care how much they smile. Oh, they provoked. Okay, I ain't talk to you no more. Well, thank you, because I ain't doing that, motherfucker, bitch. No, motherfucker. Don't make me have to kill you. Don't want to have to go there. I'm not going to do that. Let me keep my boundary, because we ain't playing. Now, I'm sorry you triggered my vodka. Kind of energy. I be saying this inside. I be saying all this inside. I be like, okay, yeah, got that one. Thank you. Like, team, moving on to the next one. What's this? Who this? But it's more common. What I figured out is that it's more common And that a lot of people, we get all tripped up because these are people who have all of this money and they have homes that they've purchased and they have businesses. And we think that means they got a sound mind. No, the fuck. It don't. No, the fuck. It don't. All we gotta do is look at TV and the news and shit. I mean, I don't know why we find that part difficult. It's like, have we not seen? But we get stuck there. Ooh, they got a house. Ooh, you don't know if they, look, I'm just gonna keep it real. You don't know the story behind what they got. So before we get so easily impressed, so quick to be all smiling and shit, motherfucker. They done signed some fucking documents and shit, some fucking secret society and shit to do some crazy shit, and we'll help you get some benefits. Yeah, like that. I know about them. But see, once we can just simply understand, that understanding and this awareness that I've been seeing lately, and watching how I feel when I'm around certain people, and then setting an intention, and like I'll ask my guides to come in. I'm like, man, I'd be like, what's that, man? Okay, I'm send that shit back to they bitch ass, man. I don't have time for this, man. That's how I talk too, because I'm in another vein now. I'm not in this, you know, tippy-toeed. I'm like, no, whatever the crazy amount, this crazy shit, whether it's something that they are, you know what I'm saying, intentionally sending, or if it's just a matter of, you know, like I said, when you get around people, I'll be like, well, whatever dizzy shit, let's return to sender. Let's drop it on back onto where it need to be. Thank you very much. Like, damn, let's go ahead and send out all back. Let it live in their reality, because that shit is theirs. It will not be here. So go ahead and bind it to them. Go ahead and, you know, let's just go ahead and let's keep on keeping it on. Like, team, let's do this. Let's do this on a time release upon contact with Disney density from the Disney motherfuckers. So what I've noticed is the more I do that, I'll see my own energy change too. And I'm like, so it was something connected to them or something connected to that. And I'm like, this is a trip. Their energy. Okay. So narcissists, again, I know I kind of got off topic or kind of not, but a little bit. Their generosity is not real. Okay. Their generosity has a chain. It has an attachment to it. Okay. Whether they admit this to you or not, whether it is easily seen or not. But one of the surefire markers is that when you're being generous out the heart, you do understand that it drops right there. When something leaves you, it drops. That's it. It drops. You don't get to, you know, get some special footing because you gave a motherfucker a bag of potato chips. And I'm just using that as an example. And their emotional capacity is fucked. This is why to try to have relationships with these people is a nightmare. It's volatile and it's very unsatisfying. Okay, it's usually all surface and 3D. And it's only about exchange of goods and services. There's no soul. There's no heart. only to the extent of creating an illusion to look a certain way to the world. But we'll betray you in a hot potato second, whether you're their blood or not. That should tell you something, shouldn't it? Ain't nothing divine about that. And carry a Bible all they want. Ain't nothing divine about that. So, that's why, you know, if you go to behavioral health or psychologists, psychiatrists, therapists, clinicians, individuals that are actually licensed in the field, okay, they'll probably say the same things I'm saying to you, and they will say, you know, if you don't have to have too much close proximity or relationships with these people, if it's not a situation where you kind of just have to, it'll probably serve you not to. Because their capacity, not all of them are supremely dangerous, but most of them are. And the worse they are on the spectrum of it, and the older they are, and those that, especially those that are hiding, you know, because there are a few narcs out there, I think, that gets the help, but that's very rare. It's very, 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 very rare, okay? My resonance on my journey is that it's through ascension. You can't just behavioral health your way into it. That's my resonance. You gotta fucking wake up. The 3D grid is narcissism. So we all fall under that as long as we're asleep in some way. The only way out is to awaken and ascend and go to that inner child shit, go to them, that soul shit. That's the only way, man. So to try to get a satisfying relationship, I promise y'all, listen to me, to try to get a satisfying relationship, whether this is friendship, family, or a lover, it ain't gonna happen. They are children. So what? How do children act? Stubborn, refuse to be accountable to their behavior. How does children act? Think about that. A child, and they will still lie even if you saw them break the glass, okay? Uh-oh, I didn't do it. It was the wind. Right? You got to constantly stroke them. You got to constantly keep them fed. They have really nothing that they can really offer you. So is that a healthy relationship potential make? People who doesn't have the capacity to do that? Just to say you got a connection? I don't think so. It can affect the mental health. Do your due diligence. Connecting to these types of folks too closely, too intimately, and for too long of a period of time can affect one's emotional, mental, physical health because they're toxic. There was one more thing that I wanted to mention and then I'm done, but it leaves my mind. So maybe I'm not supposed to right now. It was like, it's good though. That's not like, ooh, but I want to so bad. It's going to make a whole lot of people think like, oh, fuck me today. The whole get down done changed. Ah, oh, light team, how come? How come I can't? What is, okay. Damn, yeah, they're blocking it. What the fuck? Okay. Hold on, guys. Thank you. I'm happy now. They brought it in because I was like, man, I want us to do this. Okay, so you guys hear me talk about how we are, we're governed 90% by what's in the subconscious. Humans, us as humans, whether we are fully aware or wanting to accept this or not, we come here, okay? We come here. The brain, the subconscious, all of that is programmed. We come with blueprints. We come with energy, if you will, signatures, Akash, the Akasha, okay? But it's programmed based on whatever, you know, your soul's particular soul's journeys has been, or your ancestral lineages, personal experiences, yada, 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 yada. You came with it. Okay. This is one of the reasons why you can't really refute, or it's hard for us to be able to refute someone, because you're going to hear something like this. You try to tell someone something, let's say you're on an ascension path, and so you've went through a level of your own unplugging and you've come to some type of an awareness, and so you're dealing with your own constructs. But if you were to try to address someone, their constructs, it's real to them because it's a program. Do you guys get that? I'm trying to explain it in a very, as a matter of fact, way, because the experience is there because it's in your program. That's why. Something seems and feels real because it is to you. It's in the program. That's what you came with. And I don't want to get too deep on this particular live. But when I'm guided, I'm going to talk about some deeper stuff. Because, yes, the Akasha, the ancestry, the program that was built into creates an experience, i.e. like the Matrix. The Matrix, what creates an experience? If you look at the movie, to those there, that is a program. But to them, it's what? It's a reality. It is real. It is a felt experience. So to try to go tell that person that, no, that is actually not this and that, they're going to probably look at you like you're nuts. And then in a few minutes, if you're a chosen one, they're going to turn into an agent and try to kill you. This is why it's you can't really do it. Our experiences, these programs, this is why it feels real, right? So this is the challenge of ascension and awakening. This is why they say those initial dark nights of the soul are so jaunting. And I can say that from experience. Because now system can't compute. If you want to look at it like a computer, and you've ran off a certain operating system, or you have ran off of certain softwares and datas, and now it's malfunctioning or it's being removed, and then now it's saying system can't compute, trying to put, you know, in new data is causing what? Cognitive dissonance. System can't compute. This is why people fight. Do you guys see where I'm going with this? Because to them, their experience has been such until they are awake, ready to awaken themselves, that is going to be determined for them that way. But when we've chosen to, this is when we start going through that process, be like, what the fuck? Okay, everything is shattering. Okay, system can't compute, program malfunctioning, something's off, the glitches. Then you're kind of going into your awakening. Narcs are not. They usually don't, dear. It takes bravery. It's very rare souls that can do that. Because it's not that simple. It's challenging everything about everything. And the people that you've relied on your whole life or you fought near and dear to and close. So it's changing the whole get down. Then you got to face some dark, nasty truths that you didn't even want to believe existed. Like, oh, God damn it. Motherfucker. It's just like, because you won't know otherwise. You won't know. I'm telling you, you won't know otherwise. It was always designed that way. Somebody may say, well, what's the good news? This is the good news. The good news is you, whoever's the ones that are embracing their awakening and their ascension, they got power. And they have knowledge and understanding which turns, how they navigate their whole get down. They're not blindsided anymore. They know how to, you know, navigate through all of that with a little more ease and grace. And then they know how to co-create something differently by way of their own actions and their own intentions and their own healing and their own transformation and their own, you know, changing their own structures, even as they're continuing to observe the narcissistic template. No matter what, like I'm happy to finally be out of Sodom and Gomorrah. Yes. And for me, Sodom and Gomorrah represents Las Vegas, Nevada. I'll be visiting there, though. I have some things I got to do. But I am happy to have, you know, gotten away from there. But even and where I am now, which is certainly a more down-to-earth, earthy, you know, more humanistic, you know, kind of environment and place and location, there are narcs here. So what I find valuable is that, oh, it just the whole, all these experiences is just help me to know how to pick it up a little easier. And then when I am around the beautiful energy, I'm able to see that easier as well. There's this one place that I go to almost every week. And in this one place is I get some of the most beautiful and sweetest energy every time. And so I'm like, okay, I can tell the difference. I am able to actually pick it up. I can feel it. And I'm like, I enjoy myself every time. I look forward to it. Okay. I'll be like, ooh, I'm fencing to go do this, this, and this. Chances are I'm going to run into some nice somebody and I'm going to feel some sweet energy and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, I have other situations sometimes when I'm going on nature walks or hikes. Sometimes, you know, I'll still run into more, you know, beautiful energies, you know, especially animals for whatever reason. I don't know what's the deal with the animals right now, but the animals, you know, like to come up to me and my son a lot lately. And but they're very playful. They're very sweet to us. And so I'm able to pick that up. I'm like, oh, look at that. See, now that's what I'm talking about. Not no crazy shit. But then equally so, when I'm out and about sometimes, when I'm by myself, usually when I'm alone, and ever so often, I will, you know, still run into some odd energy. And I just, you know, I observe it. And it's helping me to learn. Like, oh, either that person, just something ain't right with them, or my energy and presence may trigger. Because what happens with a lot of narcissists, subconsciously, if they come into presence of divine beings, what happens is, no matter, you can be being nice and sweet, and you can be Sally Sue Plain, it wouldn't make a difference, okay? When they come into the presence of a divine being, they get triggered because they see something in that being that they don't see in themselves, and it stirs up every ounce of jealousy they have in them. The severe version of jealousy. Not the natural, normal kind of borderline healthy, if you know how to identify it and process type. The severe type that causes one to go into malevolence. The evil eye wanting to project out ugly energy because they're being triggered. Right? And I can feel it. See, empaths can feel that. But as we go on, it gets easier just to be able to observe it and go, okay, I don't have to even trip. But if they putting some get down, I'm going to see that. I ain't playing with motherfuckers, though. They may not never know. But I'm not playing. I'm like, okay, mm-hmm. Yeah, they fencing to go home and find a nice little surprise because, you know, they need to get their shit together and need me to fuck alone. That's what they need to do. My plan, stank ass energy, sending that shit right on the fuck back. We don't want extra. Let's amplify that by 1,000. Make a motherfucker learn a lesson. Motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? It's like, get your shit together. Go somewhere and heal and leave motherfuckers alone. Because I'm done. I done got to the done level. Done. May they receive what they need to receive. To wake the fuck up. But I don't stay there. All I'm trying to say, collective, is, you know, I'm learning how to just easily navigate it, though. Where I don't have to stay there. I ain't got to linger in it. I don't have to. I just go, okay, whoop, light team, ancestors, guys, whoop, buffer shield, return to sender. You know what I'm saying? If they doing some dumb shit, weird shit, whoop they ass, light team, shit, expose they bitch ass. Like, I'll go into a whole nother realm. Because if they're being that level of toxic to me, then I ask my team to handle accordingly. If they're not, if it's just a situation, you know, where, you know, I'm just sensing that person's energy, I still go, okay, still, that's theirs. I ain't taking that. That needs to sit in their reality, not mine. It's not my fault. They life is not my fault. And me being having a right to be here and having a right to my creativity and my divinity and shining is my birthright. And it's not my fault that that bothers them. So I ain't doing that. You know what I'm saying? Whoa. So I'm not doing that. They need to go somewhere and handle their shit. But essentially, these little things that I'm sharing, I'm hoping will help those of you who are on a similar path to just be able to catch things a lot easier, to not feel so stumped at trying to decipher between a truly, purely divine, truly generous person versus a narcissistic, generous person. Because they also do that to keep people trapped. The narcissists are really, truly the biggest codependents on the earth, but you would never know it. They need to be needed, so they like to create distraction and disruption for the ones that they complain about need them. That's deep. It's deep. It's real, though. They don't know how to stand in their own energy. Not really. So once we can just accept this without getting too upset, you know, at first we are upset, you know, especially when people do weird shit to you and you have to heal and blah, blah, blah. But just as you're moving forward and encountering these types, it's more just about observation, and then you know how to deal moving forward. Okay, is this somebody that I want to really collab with? Probably not. Is this somebody that I want to even further get any assistance from? In some cases, it may be that situation where you guys hear me say not all help is good help. Sometimes, okay, let me start investigating and look into other resources and asking my higher self to help me with that, because maybe that's a little too toxic. Maybe there's too much, you know, toxic energy tied or connected to this so-called help. Maybe I have to sell my soul for it and my whole life on this earth, this lifetime. And I don't think I want to do that. So helping you to be able to navigate more easily, and then appreciating, right? This is something else it has helped me with. So, you know, seeing the narcissistic types of energies, but then when I do encounter pure souls and pure hearts and those that operate in sweet energy, when I see it and sense it and feel it, I'm more grateful for it too. I'm like, man, this is my energy. I'm grateful to see that energy, the beauty of that in another human, right? To experience that is really truly a blessing, and it's really truly, it's actually pretty darn rare. But I'm gonna be speaking and co-creating that is not as rare anymore. It's just the reason that it's rare is because not many are awakening. Many are choosing to stay asleep. But what's happening is, due to the changes and shifts of Gaia, Earth, and the collective consciousness, what's going to end up happening, it's actually happening already. It's getting worse for those. That walking dead energy, okay? You guys hear me talk about it all the time. That's why people have become that way. It's exactly why. People who once upon a time wasn't like that, they are now. And that's because they don't want to wake up and heal. So they're going to be subject to all of those lower vibratory energies and frequencies. Because Gaia is shifting, and there's a lot of the collective consciousness. I just looked up at the clock. I saw 12, 12, 12, 20. Yep. Balance is being restored. There are a lot of other divine beings that's taken their ascension, and so those All right. Sorry about that, you guys. I was actually wrapping up and ending it. I apologize for that. I was trying to wrap it up and say, okay, I'm going to get going and blah, 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 you know. And so I didn't want to just shut off there. I wanted to say my official, you know, see y'all laters and all that good old stuff. And I don't know if I'll have time the rest of the day. But if I do, I'll see how I'm guided. Wow. Okay, and I just looked up at the clock again. I'll see how I'm guided to do a reading, if I'm guided to do something about what do you need to focus on type of reading. For the collective that's asking, what do I need to be focusing on at this time? Where do I need to be putting my energy? You know, because some people are looking for a direction in that way. We'll see if we're guided to do that for you all today. And we'll see. Okay. All right, you guys. I hope y'all, those of you who came onto my inner child play yesterday and stuff, it was fun. I plan to do more stuff like that, but using like arts and crafts and creative fun stuff. I want to make it fun, you know, because I mean, that's the whole idea. I don't want it to be boring. But it is going to be about embracing play and the inner child and doing those things that we used to do. So I'm thinking about getting like, of course, paint, you know, jacks and shit. Y'all might not even know about jacks. Just like different things and just embracing, just setting an atmosphere of laughter and play and fun and, you know, jokes and all of that stuff, music, poems, all that creative stuff that we used to just kind of just flow with. And I'm really wanting to merge more and more of that into what I do. I don't want it to be just the readings, which we need that. I don't want it to be just the Reiki, you know, and the teachings and stuff like that. And we need that. But we also need to play. And, you know, I want to be able to show that by example to you guys and hopefully to, you know, inspire you in your own way, whatever that means for you. You know, embracing the inner child and play and all of that in a healthy way. In a healthy way. Okay. All right. Until next time, I'll see y'all later.